Hello students, a very good afternoon to all of you. This is Dr. Arvind. Please let me know, am I clearly audible to all of you? Please reply me with an S in the chat box. Is my voice clear? Am I clearly audible to you? Okay, thank you for your reply. So in this session, I would like to tell you about how to write an ethics answer, both with respect to the questions that you get in ethics as well as the case studies. So rather than going me with my own explanation, I would want you to participate in this discussion. First of all, I am giving an opportunity to every one of you. If you have any doubts with respect to an attempting a question in ethics, please raise your doubts. I would be more happy if you come alive, with your video on and be active participants in this discussion. So I already took one session on how to write a case study. I don't know how many of you have participated in that discussion or not, but in this session, I want to clear your doubts with respect to ethics. Then after that, if you have anything more from my side, then I'll be continuing from my side. See, I have a ready-made PPT with respect to certain questions and answers, and I'll be telling you. But before going to that, I want to know what your doubts are actually.
Hello, sir. This is Harika.
Hi, Harika.
Sir, the problem is we know the most of the students, especially me, I know the concept of ethics, and every topic, but I'm not able to correlate it with answers. I'm not able to present it in answers, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, the attempting is missing. I mean, the connectivity.
Okay. Can I take an example of a question and can I explain it to you?
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Thank you.
Okay, right. You need not unmute you. Let's please be silent. And let me explain it to you in between if you have any doubts with respect to it. And you can raise that doubt immediately.
Sure, sir. Sure.
Yeah, Harika, let me give you one question. I'll be giving you a statement. See, courage is a moral guardian of all the other virtues, elucidate or explain or discuss. So this is a statement.
Okay, sir.
Courage is a moral guardian of all other virtues. Elucidate, explain, describe, whatever it may be. So in this question, what do you expect you to write? I mean, what is your intention of writing it? Can you please tell me? Can you let me know?
Sir, highlighting courage in our aspects.
Okay, first you will define what is courage.
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, you define courage. Next, what do you do? Would you quote any statement with respect to courage given by any thinker if you have in your in your mind? Will you be able to quote it? Okay, you'll quote a thinker who has given a statement who had made a statement on courage. Then followed by
some of the case studies or examples.
What case study? See, first of all, look at that statement. I made a statement that courage is a moral guardian of all other virtues.
Yes, yes, sir.
So whatever you write, it has to be justifying this statement.
Yes, sir.
Am I right?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, first of all, what did you understand by that statement? It is stating that courage will protect all other virtues.
Yes, sir.
Or I can say that if you have courage, you can exercise all other virtues. For example, you are a good person, you're a knowledgeable person, you have wisdom. But in order to act according to that wisdom, what is required is courage. For example, there is a superior who is telling you to do some corrupt practice. But what does your wisdom or knowledge tells is that it is wrong. But in order to exercise as per that wisdom, what is required? Courage. If you have courage, you will say to the superior that, no, I'm not going to do this.
Yes, sir.
Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So what is required? First of all, understanding the quotation or understanding the quote and relating it to our terms. See, after all, why we are writing this exam? we are writing this exam to become a public servant or a civil servant. So in any answer that you write for any statement that is given in the exam, you should display that quality.
Okay.
So for any statement, if you are elaborating, if you want to elaborate that statement, you need to link it. So for example, I presented this with respect to this statement. If you look at it, so first of all, what did I do? I said that, see, for me, what is courage? See, this is courage for me. What is courage? It is understood as ability to face pain without showing fear. You may have your own definition. That is not, that is very much acceptable. There is no one single standard definition. Okay. And at the same time, you need not mug up, except those Nolan 7 principles and to every principle, whatever that is given in the lexicon. Apart from that, you need not mug up any definition. You can have an understanding of a word of your own understanding. Am I clear to you?
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
So apart from that, Nolan 7 principles, integrity, openness, objectivity, so selflessness, that 7 principles, 7 Nolan principles, you need to mug up those basic definitions which are given from lexicon. Apart from that, you must read some 20 to 30 vocabulary terms. So for every vocabulary, you need to have a 3 to 4 line understandings about that word in your own terms. You need not mug up something which is very hard to remember. So try to put that word in your own terms, which is very much acceptable. So for me, courage is that something which is understood for me as ability to face pain without showing fear. So this is courage for me. After that, I have quoted a statement or a statement on courage given by Nelson Mandela. So for Nelson Mandela, courage is not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it. Courage is the first of human qualities because it is the quality that guarantees others. See, it is the quality that is guaranteeing others. Why? Because if you have courage, you will be able to exercise other values or other virtues. So apart from that, I know some John Locke statement that courage is an act as courage to act as God and support of all other virtues. Then now, apart from this, now a small understanding or a small definition has been given, followed by I have made a quote of a thinker, whoever thinker, which I remember, I have put it there. Now, the next step is that now I have to justify the sentence that has been given or a statement that has been made in the question. What is that statement? Courage is the moral guardian of all other virtues. Now, what will be my next step? I will be relating this courage to all other virtues in ethics. So first of all, rule of law. So rule of law, if you are supposed to act as per rule of law, you need to have courage. See, if at all you become an IPS, IAS or whatever officer, you need to act as per rule of law. But there will be some other people. So you will be working in administration. There will be some politicians, ministers who will be forcing you. So in order to act as per this rule of law, you need to have courage. So you need to say no to those politicians who are making you to work against rule of law.
Okay, sir.
Next. So in order to act as per compassion, for example, you all know Sunita Krishnan, she runs a NGO by name Prajwala, and most of the times she deals with the girls who are being sexually exploited or who are being put into prostitution. So her role or her NGO works mainly to rescuing those girls and rehabilitating her properly. So in this endeavor, she used to get so many threat calls, but beyond that, she has risen. So she was able to meet the goal, or she was able to work for that goal. So what is that compassion and empathy? Beyond that compassion and empathy, what is that virtue that is driving her? Yes, she has got compassion and empathy. But at the same time, if she doesn't have courage to face the goons, she may not be able to display that compassion and empathy. Is it clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
Right. Now let us look at another quality. So integrity is guarded by courage. So Shankaran has resolved so many land reforms. He was able to abolish bonded labor. He was like messiah of tribal people. So he was able to do all this irrespective of political pressures or administrative pressures. Why he was able to do this? Yes, he is a man of integrity, but in order to display that integrity, he need to have courage.
Yes.
Similarly, wisdom guarded by courage. So in all these ways, so you take up one quality. In order to display this quality, you need courage. So provided for every quality, you need to add an example, a good example. So for this, what is required? You need to read every vocabulary, I mean ethics, whatever the vocabulary that you get, in a proper way. For what that? For example, if you take the quality of integrity, if you look at it, you need to understand its definition. What is integrity in your own terms? Followed by, are there any types of integrities? Now, how to inculcate this value of integrity? Then followed by, what are your examples in your personal life, professional life, and historical examples? Where there, for example, in history, you come across so many freedom fighters, but we never look in a such a manner that, is there any quality which that freedom fighter has displayed, and can we use it in ethics? So you need to think in that fashion.
Okay, sir.
Am I getting you?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So this is the way of presenting. First, a small definition followed by a thinker, then relate to the question. So I am justifying the statement by presenting so many virtues which are required. In order to exercise those virtues, I need courage. So that is the way of presenting this answer.
Okay, sir.
And one more thing. See, whenever with respect to ethics is not something which you can learn on a day one itself. See, it is a continuous process. Unlike other subjects, what ethics required is daily half an hour of study. In that half an hour, you study for 10 minutes, and remaining 10 minutes, you write one answer, question and answer that you get in the first part of ethics paper, followed by one case study every day. So in doing that, you can also check into the topper's copies, which are available freely on so many websites. So don't look for any other question from a particular institute. You can pick up any topper's copy. For that question, this topper has written some certain answer. You just cover that answer. To that question, try to write your answer and check out with that topper answer. That will be a much better way.
Okay, sir.
And this practice has to be done continuously. See, after all, you need to get ideas at one point of time in a given time span of 7 to 8 minutes. So in order to work brain in such a fashion, you need to first practice. You need to make your brain do that thing every time, every day, for at least half an hour. Only then you can put that points or put that ideas in one place at one point of time in a given time very quickly. That is possible only by practicing.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Moreover, I'm telling you one more thing. Don't make your ethics notes very bulkier. Read very less quantity and more number of times.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Whether I don't know whether you are there with respect to Diadem IAS, I have given my own ethics content very well compiled, very short notes, which is more than sufficient. So better do revise it multiple times.
Yes, sir. I'm into Diadem IAS, sir. I have gone through ethics notes. Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Next, any doubts? Anyone? Okay, some chat box. Just a minute. Yeah, how to start preparation with respect to ethics? See, first of all, take my own book or my content and start reading it. That itself is more than sufficient. And I want to tell you something with respect to thinkers. See, most often what you do is that when you are asked to read about thinkers, you take up some institute material, and that material will be very bulky and it is very difficult to understand. With respect to thinkers, just type that thinker name in the YouTube and you will get a very good 3 to 5 minutes of videos. Not more than that, just 3 to 5 minutes of videos. For example, type the name Socrates in YouTube. You will get 3 to 5 minutes. Only listen to those 3 to 5 minutes of videos. Like that, do for every thinker and listen those short videos. You will have a very great and good understanding. Why? Because the language that is used in those 3 to 5 minute video on YouTube is that very simple language which is understood by school children. So what is required is simple language and to the crux point. So don't go on running behind the very, very, very difficult jargon so that you cannot interpret in the exam. So please listen, every thinker, you type the name of every thinker on YouTube, you will get very good 3 to 5 minutes videos. So try to listen to those videos and try to make a short notes. At the max, what you do in the exam is that you will write about Socrates about just two lines. You will just mention, you will add him as a reference. So unless and until you are asked to write about Socrates, that is very minimal chance. See, you will not be asked to write about a thinker. For example, we might have got some 2016 or 17 some question with respect to John Rawls' theory. That is a very rare situation. So at the max, what we do is that we quote the thinker with respect to any question or case study, whether if that particular thinker fits into that case study or question. So at the max, we write about one line or two lines. So your thinker notes or your notes with respect to thinker should not be more than five pages, five A4 size pages. That is more than enough. From Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, Jeremy Bentham, Hobbes, Nisha, some 10 thinkers are there. That is more than sufficient. And your note should be very crisp, not more than five pages. Next, how to deal with this quote-based questions. Yeah, just now I have explained you about courage. So that is a quote and that is the way you have to deal with it. See, every quote need not have the same format which I have presented just now. Depending upon the quote, the presentation varies. For example, I may present a quote with respect to taking a social, economical, political, cultural areas. Or I may say that in my personal life, in my professional life, in my personal, professional, or in my, in my familial life or in my family. So depending upon the quote, my side headings keeps on varying. How to interconnect topics with keywords. Yeah, see, your ethics answer is always incomplete if you don't write a proper ethical terminology. If you go through the syllabus, you will find some 20 to 25 key ethics words which you have to incorporate in your answer that you should do compulsorily. For example, all those seven principles of ethics, then followed by emotional intelligence, EQ, IQ, code of conduct, code of ethics, attitude, aptitude, moral attitude, political attitude. So all these things from the first topic to the last topic, whatever the ethical jargon that you get, that has to be on your tips and you should write those terminology in your ethics answer wherever it fits properly. So for that, see, every day take one term, take one terminology of ethics and try to put some examples with respect to that term that you get. For example, any term, to the notes that I have given, I have incorporated three level of examples. For example, at the personal level, at the professional level, at the historical level, or any example from the history. So like that, for every term, you need to have an example which you can write it in just two lines. So see, first of all, you need to build up the content. For that, you need to read or you need to remember certain content, minimum content. So without that, you cannot jump onto the answer writing. So first of all, for every terminology, you need certain basic knowledge. And the notes that I have provided is more than sufficient to score 130 plus in ethics. So if you don't have that notes, please kindly get that notes and start reading it. See, how to interconnect topics and keywords. See, interconnection. For example, let us look at the same statement which I have taken. Courage is a moral guardian of all the virtues. See, the statement is connecting with all the other virtues. You need to interlink. So in order to display courage, you need all other virtues. What are all the other virtues? That has to be on your fingertips. So once you read Socrates, you will know about wisdom. You know about virtues, happiness. So Anywhere you incorporate reading minimal things, minimal quantity and rewriting it multiple times and putting it on paper in a relevant way will help you to build a good quality answer. Yeah, how to write case study? I'll tell you how to write case study. I'll take a session. So just give me some time. Let me first finish the first part. So with respect to question and answers, I'll first clarify the doubts, whatever doubts the students have. How to increase marks? See, how to increase marks means the way you present an answer improves. So in that improvement comes from writing good amount of words, ethical words in the answer with good amount of examples, with good quotes or good quotations or good introductions or ability to interlink whatever you write with a real life example. So in that way, you can increase the marks. Introduction. With respect to introduction, so first of all, there are two parts in ethics paper. With respect to case studies, I'll tell you briefly how to write that intro. And with respect to case question and answers part, see, at the max, you will get a code-based question, one or two code-based questions, then there will be at least 3 to 4 questions directly lifted from the syllabus. For example, utilization of public funds, or what do you understand by code of conduct or code of ethics, or what is ethics? These kind of questions. Directly you can start your introduction with the definition, plain definition. So even the just now example, you can start that answer directly by defining what is courage. So if you are, for example, if in any other quote that you get in the exam, if you are able to pick up the key word of that quote, for example, in this quotation, what is asked is that courage. For example, any quote with respect to non-violence is given by Mahatma Gandhi. In that circumstances, you can directly start by defining what is non-violence. Then you can start your body part of the answer. Or else, for any statement, for example, for a question, for example, just now I have given you a statement about courage. So I can restate it. For example, in the contemporary times, most of the civil servants are now displaying courage. Elucidate. So if I write a question like this, you can use my own question as an introductory quote. For example, to this question. So once again, I am repeating, if I give you a question, in the contemporary times among the civil servants, the virtue of courage has been declining. Elucidate. So this is the question. How will I start? I state that courage is a moral guardian of all other virtues. Socrates. Just I'll put this quote and I'll start this as, I'll take this as my intro and I'll jump to the body part. So you can use the quote, or you can use any factual information, or you can use any statement made by the public, contemporary figures or any popular figures like Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel or our Prime Minister Narendra Modi, or any personality which is relevant to that question or statement. Even you can use that statement, or you can use any factual finding of any report, or you can use that as an intro. There is nothing wrong in it. So how to form various dimensions while writing the answer. So, and also facing issues. Okay, I have answered. Ethics doubts, how to address code-based questions. Okay, Niharika, just now I have explained you how to write a code-based question. Different ways of introduction and conclusion. Different ways of introduction and conclusion. See, depending upon the question, you can write an intro directly by picking up the term and defining it. Or if at all if you have any quotation that is relevant to the given question, you can put that quote as an intro. Next, conclusions. In the conclusion, you can quote any committee recommendation with respect to that quality that generally you write in a GS answer. Or you can use any other thinker who have made a statement about that quality as a conclusion also. There is nothing wrong in it. So for case studies, I have some 6 to 8 ways of introducing. So for GS, for this first part where you are supposed to write some 10 to 12 answers, there are certain standard type of introductions. See, writing a definition is a standard way, followed by a code-based thing, or you can write any report which is relevant to that quality. So these are the 3 basic ways of writing an introduction. Different ways of structuring an answer. See, how do you structure? For example, you are given a code-based question, so this is the way you do it. Followed by this, you can write social, economical, political, cultural way. So for any quotation or for any answer, you can put these dimensions. Or you can write that personal, professional, historical dimensions, you can write it. Basics of attending any ethics question. See, any ethics question, you need to write comprehensively. So you should not leave any answer. I mean, you should not leave any dimension. For example, I'll tell you in the coming discussions, I'll tell you how to cover every dimension. For example, in the case studies, this whatever the question that has been asked by Niharika is very important. How to cover every dimension, I'll tell you. Sir, I'm a mains maximizer class. Sir, on dashboard ethics lectures and notes are provided. Yes, those are my notes and my videos. You can watch through it. How to write? Yes, I'll tell you. With respect to case studies, just give me some time. I'll tell you how to write case studies. Which approach makes better in case study? Okay. Sir, can we give us basics of answer writing? Case studies first and then we ask our questions. Okay. Okay. Yeah, you can write in for a point format. You can also write in flowchart format. See, what is required in UPSC is whatever you want to communicate to the examiner, that has to be communicated in a better way. Whether if you are able to do it in points or paragraphs or flowcharts, that is immaterial. Whichever way you feel comfortable and whichever way you feel that I'm communicating in a much better way to the examiner, you can choose that method. See, with respect to second ARC, with respect to second ARC, most of the second ARC is about corruption, all those things. So the second ARC is useful to an extent in writing from fifth and sixth chapter. If you look at ethics, that probity and governance part, in that area, you will be able to use that second ARC report in conclusion or in introduction. So remaining that where the core ethics concept, you cannot use those second ARC. So how to relate current affairs? So let me tell you, I want to share one more concept with you. So some students are asking me about current affairs topics, how to write about it. I'll share you one topic with you right now. So is it visible to all of you, animal ethics? Please reply me with a yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. Now, if you look at this, so with respect to animal ethics, everybody will write the definition and what are all the ethical issues, because everybody knows you'll be using animals in experimentation, or you'll be using them in circus, or you'll be using them to as a food, hunting, zoos, pet keeping. Everybody will write. But what is more critical here is that, so what are the issues concerning with them? So in that, so remember, see, you all know this, but to put into this examination point of view or put into on paper, accumulating all your knowledge, whatever you know, is a little bit tricky here. For example, you know that fundamental duties, you have written in quality. But in that fundamental duty, there is a quality that we should express we should have compassion towards fellow living creatures. You can write this fundamental duty not only with respect to animals. If you look at properly, if at all, if you get any question with respect to environment, if at all, if you get any question with respect to women, if there is any question that one person has been destroying the public property. So it is your fundamental duty to not to do it. So whatever you read it in quality, that you should be able to bring it and write it here. So this, how will you solve this ethics? How will you solve these issues concerning animal ethics? So by looking at our constitution, it is my fundamental duty to have compassion towards fellow living creature. Then apart from that, what does we do? For example, Indian Pharmacopoeia, this you get in economics book. What we know recently, we have moved to animal free testing methods. So ethical issue is solved. We are no longer using the animals. Then Isha Upanishad has said that every creature has an equal right to life. no one has a right to dominate or exert its dominance over others. Again, by looking at our Upanishads, I can say that this ethical issue can be solved. Then followed by that, with respect to animal and culture. So, Prevention of Cruelty Towards Animals Act. What does this act do? It will prohibit torturing of animals in any way. Even you have certain judgments which you come across in the polity, which you forget most often. See, Uttarakhand High Court declared that animal kingdom as a legal entity. If you declare anything as a legal entity, then it should be prohibited. The torture should be prohibited. Why? Because it has got certain legal rights. At the same time, you should also remember one more thing if I tell you this. You should also remember that Ganga has been declared as a legal entity. Then polluting, if you get any question with respect or any case study about river pollution, you should be able to incorporate that judgment there. Now, Supreme Court, what has it stated on Animal Welfare Board versus Nagarajan case? Unless and until there is no conflict between culture and law, culture will prevail. But if there is a conflict between culture and law will prevail. Why? Because we are living in a society which is governed by rule of law, but not rule of culture. So Prevention of Corruption Act is a welfare act. So what welfare? It is for welfare of animals. So for that act, welfare of animals is primary criteria. So this has to be your presentation. If you are putting these many arguments about how an animal ethics or issues arise, ethical issues arising out of animal ethics can be solved in these many ways by looking at these many references, your answer is more than perfect. See, what most often people do is that they will stick on to only one thing and try to explaining it in a much bigger way, which will not fetch you more marks. See, you have taken a stand. That stand has to be justified by multiple dimensions. The same thing we do in ethics case study, I'll tell you in just 5 to 10 minutes time, in the coming time. So this is the way of presentation, ethics. So how do you address the issue of animal ethics? So what every student, even a mediocre student, will write ethics definition and ethical issues. Why? Because we all know what issues the animals face. For example, they'll be used in zoos, they'll be used in circus, they'll be used as a servants to human beings, they'll use as food. So in whichever format that is possible, we'll be using it. All those are ethical issues. But addressing that ethical issue, this is all required. This is the trickiest part. So addressing a question with multiple dimensions. So most often you think that ethics is something which has to be written only from the ethics syllabus is wrong. Whatever you get in polity, whatever you get in economics, whatever you get in day-to-day life, that can be incorporated here to justify your stand. Yeah, now I'll start my case studies discussion. Then afterwards, you can ask your doubts. Just give me 2 minutes time. Let me open that PPT. I think you all, if you can see my PPT, ethics case study discussion.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So first of all, 4 golden rules with respect to attempting the case study is that you need to see, you are asked to write some 6 case studies in the exam. First golden rule is that avoid monotony. You should not write every case study in the similar format. Then what are the different ways? I'll tell you, don't worry. Next golden rule, only solve previous year case studies. Don't solve any case study from any coaching institute. Don't try to solve it. Only first of all, you try to solve previous year case studies. After that, if you feel that you have sufficient time, then only jump to other material. Now, in solving these case studies, don't try to solve all the case studies at a time. Only one case study per one day. And this has to be a regular exercise. So from right from beginning from 2012, I think you have some roundabout some 40 to 45 case studies. So that 45 days, you do this exercise on 15 every day, 15 minutes. So try to attempt that case study and look at the case. I have attempted all the case studies. I have given the answers and try to look at the way I have written. I have shared this PPT with the Diadem IAS and I have solved almost every case study right from beginning from 2012. First of all, you try to solve the case study on your own basis. Then only look at the case study the way in which I have attempted it. Now, daily practice one case study. Now, what is this fourth golden rule? Just wait for 5 minutes, I'll tell you. Now, what are the different ways? For example, introduction. So many students have asked me how to write a good introduction. See, with respect to introduction, you can use a quote. For example, if you have encountered any case study, or if you have got, for example, in the first part, you may have any question with respect to women. At that time, you can use a quote directly of any Vivekananda with respect to women. If it is of a civil servant, the case study is particular to any civil servant, and you know any quote that perfectly fits there, try to put that quote as an intro. Or the second way of introducing, any contemporary statement by any contemporary leaders. You need not always write the statements of previous thinkers. You can also quote certain statements which most of the contemporary leaders also make. For example, Kailas Satyarthi says that, all my ideas have been born out of anger. For example, let me explain you this. See, most of the time we look at anger as something called a negative emotion. See, in ethics, we have something called emotional intelligence. We write about emotions. Most of the time we look at emotions as something which is anger is a negative emotion. This is an old school of thought. We have something called a new school of thought. Yes, anger is a negative emotion. This is as per old school of thought. But as per new school of thought, if you have a negative emotions and you channelize those emotions in a proper direction, then the outcome will be positive. This is what Kailas Satyarthi statement is. For example, all my actions have been born out of anger. So Kailas Satyarthi is channelizing his anger towards a social cause. What is that social cause? Child labor. Are you able to get my point? Kailas Satyarthi is channelizing his anger to a social cause. What is that social cause? Child labor. And the outcome is positive. Likewise, if you have anger. So here you can make a contrary statement. For example, Buddha makes a statement. If you are holding on to an anger, it is like holding on to a coal. And if you are throwing this anger towards your fellow beings, first you are the one who gets burnt. This is one statement. Yes, anger, as per this statement, anger is a negative emotion. If you hold on to anger, you are the one who gets burnt first. But this is an old school of thought. What is a new school of thought? If you channelize this anger by using your emotional intelligence in a socially relevant manner, the outcome can be positive. The justification for this is that the statement of Kailas Satyarthi, all my actions have been born out of anger. When my actions are born out of anger, I'm channelizing my anger towards a social cause, that is addressing my child labor. So in that way, you have to think. So two statements, two contrary statements. One statement is also justified, other statement is also justified. So I'm addressing both sides of the coin. Case highlights. So bring it, for example, in certain case studies, directly you can state that the following case study tests attitude, aptitude, emotional intelligence, or integrity, etc. types of qualities in me. Simply, you can write that as an intro itself. Then followed by stakeholders. Write stakeholders in every case study. And that stakeholders presentation simply by stakeholders, arrow marks, or writing stakeholders and rounding it up and just putting certain lines and writing it, whatever format you feel comfortable, write it, no problem in it. Then followed by ethical issues involved. Now, how many types of case studies? If you look at from 2012 to now, there are some 6 varieties of case studies that are being asked in the ethics exam. For example, in a case study, you will be given options and you are asked to evaluate the merits and demerits of that option itself. So your option is directly given in the question itself. You need not write your own option. The option is given in the question and you are asked to evaluate the merit and demerit. And after that, you are asked to choose which option you will exercise it. Next, you will be put into a dilemma and asked to take a stand and justification for that stand. This is another variety of case study. Next, but in a third variety of case study, you will be asked to write the entire course of action that you take. And in that course of action, what are all the qualities that are tested in you? This is a third variety of case study. Now, fourth, consequences asked. So mention the consequences when a consequence is asked. So you have case studies. You have stakeholders. For example, you have 5 different stakeholders. Try to mention the consequence with respect to every stakeholder. Then the answer becomes easy. So when the stakeholders are there, if your action brings out certain consequence with respect to X stakeholder, then write that. So this becomes very much easy. So when you are asked to write about the consequences, try to think about that consequence with respect to every stakeholder. Then when you are writing about reforms, try to divide this into short-term reforms, long-term reforms. For example, there is a corruption happening in a particular office which you are working. You know about it. So your solution should be such a way that it should not be addressed until you are there in the office. Even if you leave that office, again, that corruption should not happen. So that should be your long-term reform. I think all of you are getting my point. Your solution to that problem it should be such a way that even when you leave that office, that corruption should not happen. So another thing, reforms at the individual level or institutional level, you can also categorize your reforms in this manner. Now, identifying the various dimensions of the crisis and suggest the measure to deal with it. So these are the 5 basic varieties of case studies. If you look at from 2012 to most recent one, all the case studies fits into these 5 different varieties. You can check it out. Now here, I have not mentioned the 4th golden rule. What is that 4th golden rule? So this 4th golden rule is the justification part. So same justification part that you use in the ethics answer itself. For example, if you are asked to justify certain things, that justification you should not do only on one basis. For example, you can't justify. For example, just now we have discussed about animal ethics. So that animal ethics, I have justified it in so many ways where I have used a fundamental duty. I have used the scriptures, like example, Upanishads. I have taken the laws. I have taken the judgment. If at all, is there any policy, I will also take it and justify my stand. So the most critical part that most of the students miss out is that, see, for example, look at the second one. You are put into a dilemma or situation, asked to take a stand and justify the stand. If you justify the stand only on one basis, for example, doing certain thing is ethically wrong. Just baking by that statement and elaborating that statement, you will not get good marks. That justification has to be done. Similarly, see the how two lawyers argue in a court of law. Simply, you should think the examiner as another advocate and try to convince it in such a way that there should not be any counter argument. So, in order to do that, you should buttress your stand on multiple dimensions. What are those multiple dimensions? If you look at these 11 dimensions, if you are able to put these 11 dimensions on a paper on your wall and try to look at it on everyday basis, if you try to justify every stand on these 11 parameters, your answer will be 100% perfect. For example, you have to justify your stand on the basis of ethics or human values that you study in the ethics syllabus, then followed by at a professional level. For example, my stand is against the professional integrity or code of conduct or code of ethics. Or you can invoke any country or societal value. See, our country or our societal value is respecting the woman. Our country or our societal value is pluralism, multiculturalism, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. So these are all the values of Indian society, universalism. So these are unique Indian values. If you act, if you do certain things, or if you justifying your stand on the basis of the Indian core Indian value, that is Indian universalism, you can state it. Then you can also bring a philosopher or thinker. For example, you can bring Socrates, Plato, whomever thinker that is relevant to that case study and justify your stand. Always try to bring fundamental rights, fundamental duties, preamble, justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, those 4 words, followed by every fundamental duty as per the relevance of the case study or fundamental right as per the relevance of the case study. Next, judgments, whatever the judgments that you study in the polity, laws, policies, logic. Now, what is this logic? For example, you got a case study somewhere in from 2012 to 20. I don't remember. See, you are supposed to go to UPSC interview exam, and on the way you have seen an accident. So that accident might be your relative or not, that is immaterial. So you have seen an accident. So what will you do? Whether you go to the exam or you help him. So that is a case study, I remember broadly. So in that case, see, in that case study, they specifically mentions that that person is a relative. So then you'll be in a dilemma that I must exercise absolute objectivity. I should not bend any towards my relative. I should go to the UPSC exam. See, that is not that is wrong thinking. See, what is logic is that if at all a person meets with an accident, there is something called golden hour. So in that, whatever actions you do has to be done in that first hour itself. So you cannot go attend the interview and come back and help this person. Why? Because if you want to help him, you have to do it in that first hour itself. So your stand can be justified on that logic also. What is that logic? You have to be a good Samaritan. Again, you have Supreme Court judgment. So persons have to be good Samaritan. So why you have to be good Samaritan? A person who meets with an accident can be saved in the golden hour. What is that golden hour? First hour immediately after the accident. So my action should be justified on the basis of this logic. Next, any factual evidences. For example, I have this evidence of Reema Rajeshwari. So in order to tell you, I have put this there. See, yeah, in COVID era, in the last year or before last year, we had so many fake messages circulating on WhatsApp. So in my place where I live in Telangana, this IPS officer could prevent all such kind of atrocities or WhatsApp fake messages, or that so many people getting beaten. All these things have been avoided in certain 4 to 5 districts. How this was possible? This IPS officer has taken the help of police officers who are well versed in local culture. For example, they know folk singing and folk dancing. So from that police department, she picked up those officers, and they were asked to play those singing. They were asked to educate the people through that folk song and folk dances in everywhere in the villages. So usually what happens is that if you are trying to communicate this folk arts, people gets attracted towards it very easily, rather than sending that messages through newspapers or TV channels. If you use that folk art, so suddenly you get attracted and you try to know what is happening there. So after all, what is required for us is that we must be able to communicate what we want to communicate to the people in a much easier manner. So that is done here. So similarly, you can pick up those kind of case studies and put that as a justification to your answer. I think every one of you getting my point, please reply me with an S in the chat box. Yeah, what this PPT is, entire PPT and every case study, whatever from 2012 to now, before last year paper, I have solved every case study and I have given to you. It is available at Diadem.is. You can ask Rahul Kumar, sir. Okay, now let me explain you one case study. We'll deal with one case study so that you can be able to better understand what I'm trying to tell you. Now, all of you, please read this question. So there is an apparel manufacturing company with having a large number of women employees, and this company has been losing sales due to various factors. The company has hired a reputed marketing executive who tried to increase the volume of sales within a short period of time. However, some unconfirmed reports have come up to the management that this person has been indulging in sexual harassment at workplace. So the moment you read this sexual harassment at workplace, what you should get in your mind? You should get that Vishakha judgment, Prevention of Sexual Harassment at Workplace Act. So these three things should strike your mind. Next. After some time, a woman employee launched a formal complaint to the management against the marketing executive about sexually harassing her. Okay, she has lodged a formal complaint. Now, faced with the company's, but the company has been indifferent to her. The company is not taking cognizance of her for grievances. So after that, she has went to the police and lodged an FIR. Okay. Realizing the sensitivity and gravity of the situation, now the company has called the woman employee to negotiate. In that, she was offered a hefty sum of money to withdraw the complaint and the FIR, and also given writing what the marketing executive is not involved in the case. That the marketing executive is not involved in the case. Now, identifying the ethical issues involved in this case, what options are available to the woman employee, right? Yeah, I'll tell you, Diadami, that I'll inform Rahul Kumar sir to once again share this PPT with you. You need not worry. Okay. Now, see, there are certain keywords, and this case study tries to, I mean, by stating that large woman employees. So the immediately you'll be put into a dilemma that, okay, I should not act harshly. But because there are so many women employees. So in that way, you should not think. At the same time, when you are going to UPSC, the case study states that the person who met with an accident is your relative. Again, it puts a dilemma in your mind that, okay, he is my relative. I should not act in a favorable way towards my relative. You should not think like that. You should act in a way that is correct and that is justifiable. So large woman employees. And in the first sentence, in the first paragraph, the case study says that the reports are unconfirmed. But afterwards, what did the woman do? She has launched a formal complaint. It means that the sexual harassment has been happening. Now, what did the company do? Did it act? No, it did not act. It failed to act. So again, here the company also is committing certain things that is not just legally wrong, but also ethically wrong. So when you are reading this case study, you should also get one more thing in your mind. Since you have read the GS, so we have something called internal complaint committee. So whenever this internal complaint committee, as per this committee, any organization should have this internal complaints committee. So whenever a woman employee faces this sexual harassment, that organization should constitute an internal complaints committee and should ask this committee to investigate that complaint. So this also you should get in your mind when you are reading this case study. Then afterwards, an FIR has been filed. Now, what did the company do? The company is doing the dual wrong. I said that at the first instance, it has committed one wrong. What is that wrong? It did not act it. Again, it is doing one more mistake. What is that mistake? It started negotiating with the woman, which is not just illegal, but also unethical. So addressing every part of the case study is very, very important. So what is this every part? Why I'm stressing on this is that in this case study, you attempt the case study in such a way that your entire focus will be on and addressing that marketing executive. But at the end, you should also mention a point that woman should also launch a complaint on the company itself because of this illegal or unethical act. Then only your answer becomes complete. We will see in the coming slides. Okay. So what is this introduction? I have taken the introduction of Immanuel Kant. What does the Kant say? People should not be treated as a means, but an end in themselves. What is the company doing here? The company is just treating their employees as a medium to achieve its goals. But people should not be treated in such a manner. They are end in themselves. They have got certain rights. So not just growth and individual well-being, but the human resource are very much important. This can be achieved through equality, justice, and fair play. Here, the woman is just denied equality. The woman is denied justice, and there is no fair play. Why? Because the company is bending towards the marketing executive. It is displaying bias towards marketing executive. It is not acting fairly towards the woman employee. So any term that I am using here, any particular term that I am using here is completely relevant to the case. I'm not just randomly putting the words. I'm putting every word in such a way that is relevant to the case study. Now, what are all the stakeholders? Just simply, you can write the case studies in this manner also. Woman employee, management, that marketing executive, co-workers, entire company itself. Now, what are all the ethical issues? On one side, the company is having profit, but at the same time, the fundamental right of that woman, right to live with a dignity, is. So these are two contrasting ethical issues that are being collided. Now, right to dignified life on one side and job security. If the woman opts for this, she might be removed from her job. Then reputation of the company on one side and empathy and sympathy of the empathy. See, the management is looking for reputation, but on the other side, the company is not displaying empathy and compassion towards the woman employee. Next, rule of law versus career of marketing executive. If you act as per rule of law, the career of marketing executive you will put an end to that career. Why? Because that person has committed something which is legally wrong. And if you act as per law, he has to be removed and he has to be put into the court of law. Now, what are all the options that are available in this case study? Take money, withdraw the FIR, and give in writing that marketing executive has done nothing wrong. This is the least option that is available. Second option, taking the money, withdrawing the FIR, but asking for a written or oral apology in front of all the staff by that woman employee. Now, don't take money and stick to the formal complaint. Now, this is my stand. That woman employee should not take money and she should stick to the formal complaint. But now, this is very simple in stating, but I should justify my stand in whatever that 11 parameters. Now, let us look at those parameters. All human beings, irrespective of gender, have dignity and it should be respected. Now, wherever women are respected, God exists. This is stated by Vivekananda. Now, in the first justification, I have used those ethics or morals, then followed by I am quoting a thinker. What this thinker Vivekananda has said, wherever women are respected, God exists. In this case, the women are not respected and their God doesn't exist. So I should not want such kind of company. As a professional, this particular marketing executive has violated the code of conduct and code of ethics. Now, I have justified my stand on the basis of professional conduct. Then I am using this fundamental duty. It is our fundamental duty to renounce any practices that are derogatory to the dignity of women. Next, I am justifying my stand on the basis of fundamental right, that is Article 21, right to life. In that, right to dignity is an integral part of Article 21. Next, I am justifying my stand on the basis of an act. What is that act? Vishakha Guidelines or Prevention of Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Act. Next, now, patriarchal mindset. See, what does that person, that marketing executive is displaying patriarchal mindset, which is wrong. Now, one can buy or recruit any number of marketing executive, but not a man of integrity or ethics or morals. Whatever the success that has been shown by this marketing executive is only temporary. Long-term success then depends upon values and ethics. For example, you have an example of Wipro, Infosys, Tata. These are all known for their values and ethics. Now, I am justifying my third option. I am also rejecting my first two options. Why I am rejecting my first two options? It will set as a wrong precedent. So your answer should also state why you rejected those first two options. Now it will reinforce the attitude or wrong behavior of that marketing executive if you exercise those first two options. Finally, the woman should also lodge complaint on the company and management. Now you should answer every part of the question. This is the thing. So here the woman should also lodge a formal complaint on the management. Why? Because it did not constitute this ICC, Internal Complaints Committee, which is illegal. Then followed by unethical negotiations. So, yes, the company has got power and authority, but that is legitimate only when this is complemented by responsibility. You should exercise your power and authority in such a manner that you should also be responsible to the fellow people who are working below you. So, power and authority should be exercised in an objective manner and it should prevent this nepotism or groupism. So, this should be your presentation. So I have taken a stand. To that stand, see how I am justifying my stand. So your marks will be maximized. You will get more marks only when you justify your stand in such a way that there should not be any counter argument. Examiner should feel satisfied. Okay, I'm very much satisfied with this justification. So that is possible only when you are able to remember all those 11 dimensions which I have quoted on the slide. And if you're able to put it aside, and if you are able to justify your stand on all those 11 dimensions, your answer becomes complete. Now, with this case study, if you have any doubts, please raise your doubts. I have two complaints. Yeah, internal complaints committee. Okay, students, if you have any doubts with respect to this case study, please raise your doubts in the chat box. What are these 11 dimensions? See, these are the 11 dimensions, the justification part. So you can count it. I think these are 11. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So try to justify your stand on these bases. Yes, I find it very hard to complete ethics paper. See, the major drawback is that when you know the presentation, for example, this justification part is a crucial part where most of the students waste time. Now you put these 11 dimensions on a paper beside you and try to finish the case studies. You'll be able to finish the case study in 1 hour, 10 minutes. I mean, the ethics part, the case studies part, you'll be able to finish that part in 1 hour, 20 minutes in a much easier manner. So try to follow my method. See why? Because most of the time, what you do is that you tend to write in such a way that you end up writing more big paragraphs with not much amount of good vocabulary or not much amount of valuable content. That thing happens when you don't have a solid presentation behind your mind. You end up writing more amount of content with no good quality in it. So that thing has to be changed. So write simple, small sentences with multiple dimensions rather than beating around the bush around the same point. So most of the students, see any number of students, most of the time they try to justify only on one basis, and they try to elaborate in such a manner that everything is same in that. See, right from first line to last line, you hardly get some one or two good points. See, in this case study, simply stating, my stand is justified on the basis of Prevention of Sexual Harassment Act. Why? Because my stand is justified that this particular act of marketing executive violates this act. Just simply one line, you can put it off. Tenth point, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Tenth point, okay. So tenth point, I'm stating that you can also justify a stand on the basis of a logic. What is that logic? I am saying that in a particular case, you are in a case study. There has been a case study. I don't remember which year we have got that case study. Yeah, economic or financial. See. So you can justify on the basis of, for example, your action brings certain amount of financial loss to a company, or your action brings an economic loss to a company. You can also justify on the basis of economic principles, this action is justified. On the basis of financial principles, this action is justified. Like that also you can write. So it is also one dimension of justifying your stand. So not just logic, on economic and financial basis also, you can justify your stand. Okay, for example, in this case study, you may look at that on economic basis, on the whatever the profit that the marketing executive has shown is only temporary. And if you look at a long-term basis, the company will collapse. Just it is getting a little bit postponed, but it will collapse. Why? Because the foundational values are not solid. See, don't I need to elaborate my points? There are 3 pages per case study. How to fill, like mentioned, I end up my answer into. See, if you write these 11 dimensions will fill up the 1 page. And 1 page for intro, case study, intro, as well as stakeholders and followed by the ethical issues will take up one page, and this justification part will take up one page, and options followed by something in the end conclusion that will fill up one page. No need to worry. It is not about writing how many pages, is not immaterial, but the quality of the answer and the dimensions that you put is very much important. Don't try to be in such a dilemma that I should end up all the pages that I should write all the pages that are given in the exam. That is highly impossible. You will never be able to finish that those all the papers in the given 3 hours of time. Try to focus on the quality of the answer. Still any more doubts? Or shall I conclude? Okay, one more question. Last year there was a case study. What was that case study? See, there is no, you can take right, you can take left, you can take middle. But the thing that is crucial is that justification to your stand. Whatever the stand you might take, I might take left, you might take right, one might take middle. But whoever gives a solid justification to that stand, he will get more marks. There is no such thing that you should take a middle path, you should take a right path, you should take a rest. What is the bottom line is that your stand needs to be justified in a such a way that there should not be any counter argument. So just think as if a lawyer, for example, I am presenting this as my argument. Will there be any counter argument to it? About a firm working in a local area that had all... See, yeah, I remember this case study. See, always you will be put into the certain dilemma that that case study was everything perfect. Only one negative point that that case study has got that with respect to it was a plastic industry. So plastic industry was a sin industry. Sin industry. That means it has had a negative impact. Apart from that, the case study entire thing was always everything is perfect. So you will be in such a dilemma that you need to bring about certain negative points which are not there. It is not always like that. So in that case study was everything was perfect. I'll show you that case study. I think I can find it. Yeah, Bikesh Kumar, I got your case study. Just a minute, give me 2 minutes time. I'll show you that case study. Bikesh, is this a case study? Bikesh. Right. Yes, this is the case study. Now, all of you, please go through this case study. I think all of you, yeah, please go through this case study. So, Parmal is a small but underdeveloped district. It has got a rocky terrain that is not suitable for agriculture, though some subsistence agriculture is being done on small plots of the land. The area receives adequate rainfall and has an irrigation canal for it. Amria, its district's administrative center, is a medium-sized town. Its house is large district hospital and industrial training is some privately owned skill training centers. It has all the facilities of a district headquarters, a trunk railway line. Remember, its poor connectivity is a major reason for absence of any major industry. The state government offers a 10-year tax holiday. So, Anil, an industrialist, decided to take benefits and set up this Amria Plastic Works in Noora village, about 20 kilometers from Amria. While the factory was being built, Anil hired a required key labor and got them trained skill training center. This act has made him a key personnel very loyal to APW. It started production and labor drawn fully from the village is very happy. They got employment, homes, motivated to meet the production targets, started making large profits, sizable portion went to improve the quality of life. Noora could boost a greener village and renovated village temple, lies with local MLA to increase the frequency of bus services. Also opened a primary health care center, primary school. CSR wants to set up women health group, subsidized primary education, procure an ambulance for use by its employees and needy. So in 2019, there was a minor fire in this company. It was quickly extinguished and fire safety protocol were in place. Yeah, I'll explain you. Just give me 2 minutes time. This was soon rectified. The next year, due to nationwide lockdown, the requirement of production fell down. Just Anil decided that all employees would be paid regularly. There was plantation. It developed a reputation. Critically analyze the story of APW and state the ethical issues involved. Do you consider as a role model? See, when in the question, it has asked you about ethical issues. So every time when ethical issue is asked, you need not think about in a negative format. So ethical issue, that issue need not be in a negative tone. It can be in a positive tone also. For example, in this case study, what the ethical issues are there? Everything that ethical value or issues, whatever we are talking about, has been very well taken off. The only negative element in this case study is that plastic industry, that itself is a sin industry and it raises the question of environmental ethics. And apart from this, here corporate governance, corporate social responsibility, the sustainable development, local culture, the compassion for the locals, the accident was also not an ethical issue. Why? Because the fire protocols were put in place and it was immediately rectified. He has also displayed emotional intelligence. I can simply state that this APW can be considered as a role model for development of backward areas. There is nothing wrong both ethically and legally with industry-led welfare and growth. For example, one country grows by taking or by riding on agriculture, and another country grows on the basis of industry. One country grows on the basis of service sector. What is required is that growth of all, are sharing those fruits of development to all the people, and that is being done here with respect to APW. So don't always think in such a manner that I should bring certain negative element in this case study. There is no negative element in this case study. This was a bouncer the bouncer question that the UPSC has asked. All the time we have been running around trying to identify the negative element of that case study, but this time everything was positive. So the student is forced to think what are the negative elements. Then there are no negative elements itself. I think every one of you got my point. Bikesh. Channa Basava. Still any more doubts? compilation of current affairs based ethics, which is recently in news. So that I have not provided. You better ask Rahul sir. See, most of the time, whatever, whenever, see, ethics is something that you cannot do it or in a one day. Whenever you get an ethical point or whenever you get a case study or whenever you come across a certain situation which can be quoted in ethics, try to maintain a book and write those points with respect to that. I can bring that this particular case on in particular quality, for example, integrity or selflessness, objectivity. So try to add those points or those case studies to your notes. So it is an exercise that has to be done continuously. There is no ethical issue. See, in second and third points, it is everything ethical. See, there is no ethical issue. Is not, don't try to think in such a manner that there is something that is negative. There is nothing negative. In second and third point, he has very well taken care of the local culture. Most often when the industries come, they try to subjugate the local culture, but he has yet taken care of the local culture by constructing the temple. He has taken concern of every environmental concern there. So when environmental issue has been addressed, then the development will be sustainable. Still any more doubts? Yeah, I have already given these PPTs. Please, I'll once again remind Rahul sir to upload these PPTs. Okay, sir, last time solutions were missing. Okay, I'll tell this, tell sir to upload these PPTs. Okay, I had written some points like inequality, migration. So where is inequality here? He is addressing, I mean, Bikesh, he's taking care of every person here. Where is inequality? See, don't try to imagine yourself. See, try to think whatever you get within the boundaries of that case study. See, you can bring n number of ethical issues if you go outside that case study. Then if you are going outside that case study, means you are taking yourself into an hypothetical situation which is not mentioned in the case study. So for example, in this case study, I can say that this particular person has brought all the corrupt money into this industry. Did he mention that in that case study? It is all coming out of my own imagination from that case study. That should not happen. Whatever you think has to be within the four walls of that case study itself. See, if you use simple sentences also fine. For example, instead of writing something called wisdom or knowledge, or instead of writing like objectivity, subjectivity, impartiality, when you use these kind of words, the number of you can save more time, and the answer also looks more qualitative. There is nothing wrong in writing simple sentences, but if there are certain situations where you should bring that ethical jargon. There are hardly 25 words in ethics paper. You can simply mug up. It is not a big deal. Options available type, when he was not giving any options. Okay, Channa Basava, let me look at it. Options available type case study. Options available. Yeah, there is a course on ethics in Diademy. You can contact Rahul sir. Okay, Basava, the options we should bring out, or the options are given by the options are given in the question itself. Sir, explain one case study about options available type. Chennabasava, shall I go with this question? Here the options are directly given in the question itself. Yeah, you can use any ethic word which is not there in the syllabus also. That is nothing. There is nothing wrong in it. You can use any word. For example, commodire, spread, decorps, all these words you can use. There is nothing wrong in it. Where they ask us about what are the options available. Okay. What are the options available? Just give me a time. Chennabasava, the case study that I have discussed here, the case study, whatever you have asked is just now, this case study is about what are the options available to that woman. You want me to discuss a similar kind of another case study? So here the apparel manufacturing just now I discussed the same thing that you have asked. Okay, you want one more? I can see if I could find out. See, I am not getting that similar case study with respect to see what are the options available. I think if you want, I can discuss this case study, Chennabasava. See, you are aspiring to become, if you have any that case study, you can send it to me. I'll write an answer and give it to you. You are aspiring to become a IAS officer and you have cleared all the stages and now you have been selected for the personal interview. On the day of interview, on the way to venue, you saw an accident where a mother and child who happened to be your relatives were badly injured. Now they needed immediate help. What would you do in such situation? Or what are the options available? Can you also restate it? So what can be the introduction here? I'm again changing the introduction. I'm not using any quote. Here the case is presenting an ethical dilemma for me. My own personal goals or ambitions versus social responsibility. It puts my attitude, aptitude and EI into test. Now course of action, attend the victim immediately. give all the possible first aid and call for help, ambulance or police. Yeah, how to send case study to me? Just ask for call Dad me or CA Rahul Kumar sir. He'll give you my number. Nothing to worry. If ambulance is late, call an auto and take victim to hospital. So taking victim to hospital is only my top priority at that time. Why? Because your human life, whether it is my relative or stranger, is greater than all other priorities. Being a good Samaritan is not just legal but ethical. First hour is golden hour. Only in that hour you can save the victim. It is also my fundamental duty. Again, see, look at the justification part, how I am justifying it. It is my fundamental duty to have compassion towards fellow human beings. So call police and later briefly explain the situation and give your number and take their mobile number of hospital and police. Now go to UPSC. I'll go to UPSC and tell them the problem that I have done this. So if I am mentally stable and if time permits, I'll ask them to reschedule my interview on the same day or any other day. Here, again, UPSC may agree to my request or it may not agree. If it doesn't agree, I'll go to the higher authorities. Now, still higher authorities don't agree, I'll go to the court. Even in that court, I can get my due or still I don't get my due. If I get my due, I'm happy. If I still I don't get my due, I should also justify. See, I lost an attempt. My year-long hard work has been lost. So what? I saved a precious life. And already I became a public servant. See, after all, by becoming a civil servant or public servant, you are expected to serve the people. Here you are already served a person who is met with an accident, who saved his life. Yes, I will try again and become later also. But there is no second chance to save life of a human being. See, simple justification and very strong in words. See, one of the student, Bikesh has asked that please provide a framework for addressing a question. See, every quotation demands a different presentation. You cannot have a solid framework for all the quotations. See, depending upon the quotation, your answers and your thought process will vary. There won't be any solid fixed format. Yeah, you can use these types of flowcharts. Questions like the best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in the service of others. How to address this type of questions? You can see, for this question, I have my presentation, which I feel is good. If you have your presentation, which you feel good, please send it to me. I'll rectify it. So there is no fixed format. See, to that question, some 8,000 people will be writing. Everybody's answers will be different. But the thing is, the one which is most best suited to it, you can write personal, professional, or historical examples, or you can write social, economical, political, cultural aspects. So like that also, you can justify your answer. There is no fixed standard format, especially for the quotation-based questions. I can, for example, you have given a statement. I can take a stand which completely opposite to that question. I will say that this quotation is wrong. I will prove it through multiple dimensions. Still, I can get marks. Hope you got my point, Bikesh. Still, any more doubts? You can use these kind of flowcharts. You can use any presentation you can use. In UPSC, that is the advantage. There is no restriction on the way you present it. What is required is whatever you want to convey has to be conveyed in a more better, good manner so that examiner gets your message. So with this, I'm ending this session. Hope you all enjoyed this session and hope it is you got some valuable information out of my a little bit experience that I have got with respect to UPSC. I wish a very good luck to all of you. with respect to my number, communicating to myself with me or getting my material, you can contact with the ADMIS. The my material is already with them. My VPTs are also already with the ADMIS. Thank you, one and all.
कवर निकाला था मैं जाएंगे से एक निकाल दूसरा कवर निकाला।